You're listening to the audio production of Who Needs Christmas? Why Easter Matters Audio Bible Study by Andy Stanley. Published by Harper Christian Resources and read by the author. These audio Bible studies are a unique learning experience. Unlike a traditional audiobook's direct narration of a book's text, this production includes high-quality live recordings that cover the important points from each chapter, as well as relevant material from other sources. This audio Bible study also has a companion Bible study guide sold separately.
Here's how Christmas began. The Lord said to Abram, eventually we'll call him Abraham, the Lord said to Abram, go from your country, your people, and your father's household to the land that I will show you. Now, we're not sure why God chose Abram any more than we're sure why, you know, God chose Joseph and God chose Mary. And he tells Abraham, or Abram, I want you to leave everything you know, which was very, very dangerous, because security and safety in ancient times had everything to do with your clan, your tribe, your family, your relatives. And so he's asked to do something that's extraordinarily dangerous. I want you to leave everything you know, everyone you know, in the security of your home, and I will tell you when you get to the place I want you to go. And then the promises begin. And God says to Abram, and I will make you a great nation. Now, Abram's about 75 years old at this point. He doesn't have any children, so he may have thought to himself, great nation, I don't know about great nation. I would be happy just to be a great grandfather. Maybe we could just start with great grandfather. I don't think I'm going to live long enough to know that I became a great nation. And the promises continue. And I will bless you, and I will make your name great, which means, Abram, I'm going to make you famous. To which he probably thought, no, I'm not going to be famous. I'm going to be forgotten. Because if I leave everyone I know, and if I leave everything I know, chances are no one will ever know that I even existed. And then the promise continues. And you will be a blessing. Now, this is when, within the cultural context of these ancient times, this didn't even make any sense. Because this was a time of extraordinary violence. In fact, one of the things that kind of, you know, bugs you a little bit if you read the Old Testament is all the violence and all the bloodshed. People weren't in the habit of blessing anybody other than their family. And yet God says to Abram that you are going to be a blessing. And he says, and I'm telling you, nothing's going to get in the way of this happening, because I will bless those, you may have heard this before, I will bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. In other words, Abram, I'm going to be a part of your story, and I'm going to be a part of the people who follow you story. I'm going to be a part of your children's story, your children's children's story. I'm going to be a part of this story until this story is completed, and nothing is going to stop it. And then God gets to the completely unbelievable, incoherent, absolutely impossible part of the promise. And he says this, and all peoples, in other words, every people group, every tribe, every clan, every gathering of families, they didn't really have nations the way that we think of nations back then, but every group of people, everybody that speaks the same language, every nation, all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. That is, every single person on the earth will ultimately and eventually be impacted by your life, Abram. Everybody on the planet is somehow going to know your name and is going to be touched indirectly through what I'm about to do through you. Now, the thing that was so strange about this is, in this culture, peoples did not bless peoples. And nations did not bless nations. Nations conquered each other, nations enslaved each other, and nations plundered each other. But nations didn't bless nations, tribes didn't bless tribes, clans didn't bless clans. This made absolutely no sense in that culture. And yet, Genesis tells us that Abraham chose to believe the unbelievable. That he said to God, I don't know how this can possibly work. I don't have any children. I won't be around to see whether or not I become a nation. But because this is the promise you've made me, Abraham chose to believe this unbelievable, incoherent, literally impossible to fulfill promise. Now, if you grew up in church, or if you're Jewish, or if you know anything about the Old Testament, you know that eventually Abraham and Sarah did have a son. His name was Isaac. And Isaac had a son. In fact, we'll put their whole family tree up here. Abraham had Isaac, and Isaac had a son named Jacob. In fact, Isaac had two sons, Esau and Jacob. Esau was the oldest son. Esau's name should be up here, except Jacob was sneaky. In fact, there is so much family dysfunction and so much chaos. You should read this part of the Bible. It will make you feel better about your children and your grandchildren and even your parents and even your adolescents, okay? It was unbelievable because Jacob stole the right from his older brother to have the blessing of the older brother. If he hadn't, we'd have the name Esau up here instead of Jacob. Abraham lied about his wife. Imagine this, ladies. You know, they get to Egypt, and Abraham's afraid that Pharaoh's going to want to put Sarah in his harem and kill him, you know, kill the husband, steal the wife. And so Abraham says, hey, let's just tell everybody you're my sister. This is the guy that God chose to bless the entire world. There's so much dysfunction. There's so much chaos. Well, eventually, Jacob has 12 sons. And 10 of these sons don't like their brother Joseph. And you remember this story. So they decide to throw Joseph in a well, and they're trying to decide, do we kill him or sell him? Do we kill him or do we sell him? And you think, you know, you have some sibling issues in your family. Do we kill him or do we sell him? And they decided, we don't profit if we kill him, so let's sell him. So they sell Joseph. He ends up in Egypt. And consequently, the entire family, all of these children, all of their, you know, all these kids and all their families, they eventually migrate to Egypt, where they do, in fact, become, as God promised, a nation. But they become a nation of slaves. And for several hundred years, the people who came from Abraham, that God was supposed to bless the world through, live in Egypt as slaves, a slave nation, not feeling very blessed, and certainly not in a position to bless anybody else. And after hundreds of years, and this is the part we can't imagine, because the story, the promise of Abraham was known to these people. Father Abraham, perhaps they talked about. You know, God promised Abraham we would be a nation. Now we're a nation. And the kids are like, yeah, but we're a nation of slaves. And God has promised to bless the whole world through Abraham and through this nation. They're looking at each other thinking, well, that part of the promise can't possibly come true. And then God sent a deliverer, Moses. And without telling you the whole story, perhaps you know enough to know that by the time Moses got finished with Pharaoh, and by the time Moses got finished with Egypt, nobody in Egypt was feeling very blessed by the descendants of Abraham. And then they make their way across the Red Sea, and they make their way into the promised land, into Canaan, into the land of Canaan. And the inhabitants of the Canaanites that lived in that part of the world, they weren't feeling very blessed by the presence of Abraham's descendants either. Again, you read those parts of the Old Testament, and there's so much violence, and there's so much bloodshed, and at times it's so offensive, you think, how in the world could this be part of the story of God? And the short answer is, what offends us was so normal to them. And one of the reasons we are so offended by all the violence in the Old Testament is this. We are on the other side of Christmas. We see the world in a completely different way, but this was part of the journey, and this was part of the story as God unfolded the story of Christmas to fulfill his promise to Abram. So about 1,000 years go by after God made the promise to Abraham. And Abraham became a family, the family became a nation, and ultimately the nation became a kingdom. We know it as the kingdom of Israel. And under King David, there were peace treaties made with all the surrounding nations around this part of the world. And because David was the warrior king, he settled all the disputes. And suddenly, for the first time, the nation of Israel, the descendants of Abraham, are in a position to do something significant in the world. David is followed by his son Solomon. Solomon was extraordinarily wise. Solomon was the builder king. And Solomon just expanded the reach of the nation to such a degree that people from all over the world would come to see the wonders of Solomon's construction and to listen to his wisdom and to sit at his feet. And for the first time, it looked like Israel may be in a position to be a blessing to the rest of the world. They were wealthy and they were influential. But instead of blessing the world, Solomon chose to marry the daughters of the foreign nations and the surrounding nations. And not only did he marry their daughters, Solomon chose to worship their gods as well. And so as a response, God actually kept a promise, but not his promise to Abraham. God kept his promise to Solomon because he had warned Solomon, if you forsake me and if you go after other gods, I will divide the nation and I will tear down the temple that you built in my name. And sure enough, after Solomon died, the nation was divided. The kingdom of Israel was divided. Opportunity lost. In fact, they would never have an opportunity like that again to be a blessing to the surrounding nations. As a result of the nation splitting, there was a divided economy. There was a divided military. For the next 200 or 300 years, there was chaos in both kingdoms. And after about 300 years, the northern kingdom was invaded by Syria. And if you And if you read this in the scriptures, they refer to the scripture writers refer to the northern kingdom as Israel. So the northern kingdom is invaded by Assyria. Assyria carts off all the leading citizens and spreads them out all over the Assyrian Empire and imports a lot of other people. And eventually, essentially, the northern kingdom no longer exists. This is 300 years later. Then the southern kingdom, which is known as Judah, if you read the story in the Old Testament, Judah is on the verge of implosion, and Judah is on the verge of invasion as well. Israel can't even bless herself. Israel can't even take care of herself, much less anyone else. And in the midst of all of this chaos, as Judah, you know, prepares to be invaded by Assyria, as Judah watches the world around them change, they have no position of strength, no position of authority in the world. Right in the midst of that, God sends a prophet, the prophet Isaiah, to speak to the people. And he writes down his prophecy, and once again, this prophecy was preserved and has been preserved to where we have it as part of our English Bibles. And now imagine this, all this chaos, all this lost opportunity. They're on the verge of implosion. They're on the verge of invasion. And God speaks through Isaiah, and here's what he says to the nation. I will make you, I will also make you a light for the Gentiles. I'm going to do something through you, Israel, so that all the Gentiles, all the non-Jewish people, look in your direction, and you are going to be a light to the rest of the world. And they're thinking to themselves, they had to think to themselves when they heard this prophecy, that's a joke. We're not going to be a light. We can't even light up our own lives. We can't even light up our own world. Nobody is attracted to this part of the world. For the Gentiles, that my salvation may reach to the ends of the earth. Salvation, you're kidding. We can't even save ourselves. How in the world are we going to be a part of salvation as it relates to any other nation, any other family, any other people group? And soon after this prophecy, you're going to be a light to the Gentiles. You're going to bring salvation to the nations. Soon after that, sure enough, the Assyrians did invade. And consequently, the southern kingdom, Judah, became a vassal state to the Assyrian Empire. Another 300 years of chaos go by. The Babylonians under Nebuchadnezzar come to the city, tear down parts of the walls, destroy the city. The whole city was sacked. The temple, Solomon's temple, was destroyed just like God said it would ultimately be destroyed. The best and the brightest, the royal citizens, the most important citizens of the country are carted off into captivity. The economy is in complete shambles. There is no military. The military was completely decimated. And right in the midst of this chaos over these next 300 years, God sends another prophet, the prophet Malachi. And his words, again, as we read them, they're just impossible. I mean, when people heard these prophecies, they must have thought, you're just trying to encourage us. I mean, it's like talking to your son or your daughter after they fail, and you're trying to find anything you can to say to prop them up, and hey, it's going to work out, and better luck next time, and you know, you can do whatever you set your mind to, and all those things parents say to their kids, and the back of their minds are thinking, I hope so, I hope so. That's what these prophecies sounded like. I mean, there was no traction. There was no reason in the world to believe any of this, as they certainly couldn't believe that it was coming from the mouth of God. Here's what God said to the nation during this difficult time through the prophet Malachi. My name, he says, my name, talking about the name of the Lord, my name will be great among the nations. To which they thought, no, it won't. Your name is being mocked among the nations. Your name is a joke among the nations. Nobody looks at us and think, oh, I want to worship their God. Our God, from the standpoint of the other nations, our God is pathetic. Our God can't take care of his own people. There is no way in the world that your name is going to be great among the nations. We can't feed ourselves. We can't protect ourselves. So come on, let's stop with all the empty promises. Let's stop with all the hype. The truth is, we are never, ever going to be a blessing to any other nation. And the name of our God is not going to be made known throughout the nations. Maybe the name of Zeus will be great. And if they'd known, they would have said, and buckle your seatbelt, because Alexander the Great is about to unify all the Greek city-states, and he's about to essentially become the king of Greece and ultimately the king of all the other surrounding major nations and influencers in the world. The name of Alexander the Great is certainly going to be great, but not the name of our God. But he wasn't finished. Malachi said this.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.